Good morning from the Goddard Space Flight Center in Maryland. You're looking at a very happy group of people after a week, a long week of exciting science. This is the Hubble Space Telescope science team. Congratulations to all of you. And all of you, welcome to this the last edition of our daily Comet update for July 23rd. I'm Don Savage, the Public Affairs Officer for the Office of Space Science, and we're here at Goddard Space Flight Center today in Maryland. And I'd like to go ahead and introduce our panelists for today. This morning we'll have a look at the impact of the last comet fragment to hit the planet, which is fragment W, and we'll bring you some early results on how the planet has changed due to the impacts. And now, let me introduce our panelists. From left, Dr. Heidi Hamel from MIT, a member of the Wide Field Planetary Camera 2 team observing the dynamics of the comet's impacts on Jupiter. To her left, Dr. Melissa McGrath, a member of the Faint Object Spectrograph and High Resolution Spectrograph teams, and she's been observing the results of the comet impacts on Jupiter's atmosphere. To her left, Dr. Eugene Shoemaker joining us again, of course, a longtime comet watcher and co-discoverer of the comet, and he's an astronomer at Lowell Observatory in Flagstaff and scientist emeritus at the U.S. Geological Survey. And to his left, his wife, Dr. Carolyn Shoemaker, also a longtime comet watcher and co-discoverer of comet Shoemaker-Levy 9, an astronomer at Lowell. To her left, David Levy, co-discoverer of the comet, an astronomer and writer of popular books on astronomy and a speaker on the subject of astronomy. And to his left, Dr. Lucy McFadden from the University of Maryland and the University of California, a coordinator of the Worldwide Comet Observing Campaign and a visiting professor at the University of Maryland. And I'd like to start off by opening up the program with Gene Shoemaker. Gene.
Thanks, Don. Well, as you all know by now, the last fragment did hit Jupiter early yesterday. That is the fragments that we could resolve telescopically. But bear in mind that the trailing wing of the comet is still coming in and will be coming in over this following month. We don't know what's in that wing, but we know it gave off a lot of dust, so there may be objects there to keep track of. And as time goes on, in fact, those fragments will start to hit on the side we can see from Earth. So stay tuned on that. Lucy McFadden asked me to mention that in some of the newspaper reports, these explosions that are created by impact have been reported as some of the largest explosions in the universe. And I hope all of you will bear in mind that we're talking about the solar system, and these explosions aren't anywhere nearly comparable to a supernova, or in fact, for that matter, there's more energy in a large solar flare. So we're talking about events on planets, and it's big for that, but not for the universe as a whole. So what about that last fragment, Heidi?
Well, what about the last fragment? We actually managed to observe this last fragment, and I'd like to show you a very brief dissolve sequence so you can see images of this last fragment. If we could actually start that rolling. Here's the first image, and it's not there. You see it coming in. If we continue onward, what we saw that was unique about this one is that we actually saw it move horizontally as it moved upward. You can see it shifted a little bit to the left. And we first saw that, we thought, oh dear, we must have a registration problem. But we checked the planet very, very carefully. You see it's asymmetric. There's the lovely plume, but some little fuzz off to the side. And in the final sequence, it's gone down to the old pancake again. And that big white section you see in front is an unrelated fragment. Well, it's related because it was from another fragment, but it's not related to this plume. It's an earlier impact that occurred.
Oh my.
So we have in total, with Hubble, observed four of these plumes. A, the first one. G, the largest one. W, the last one, and the one of the ones closest to the limb of the planet, and we got a bonus E thrown in. So our hydrodynamic modelers are going to have a field day trying to model the physics of these four different plumes that we have clearly resolved the ejection mechanism. So that will be very exciting. I'd also like to show you now color image, which we got down yesterday. And if we could show that image, what this will show you is some of the evolution that we've been seeing in some of these cloud features. We haven't talked too much about that because things have been happening just much too quickly. Here is a beautiful color image that was created by Eddie Bergeron. And you can see all the impact sites. And you'll notice that they're no longer confined. They're starting to spread out along the planet. And we're studying the dynamics of that motion very carefully now, trying to figure that out. I'd like to actually show you a blow-up of the A impact site. That was the first site that we observed. And we have a close-up of that particular site. And there you can see that, first of all, the site has spread out. The winds are smearing it out. And even more interesting than that, you see that there seems to be a little curlicue tail sort of curving down to the side and looks like perhaps it's getting swept up in the motion of that little white oval. Now, that little white oval is a standard Jovian spot. We see those on Jupiter all the time. What's interesting is that the material from the comet impact seems to be interacting with it. And that's exactly what we had hoped to see. We are now looking at tracers of Jovian circulation in the atmosphere, and that's marvelous. Let me show you one more sequence that begins with A, the first image of A that we had. It's a black and white. I'm looking for my times of those so that when they give it to you, I'll be able to tell you what it is. And they're working on that. What we can see is there are many kinds of motions going on here. The ejecta blanket is moving. The actual core of this is starting to stream around. Now, this is actually later on in the sequence. We missed the first one. But you can see that what used to be a tiny streak with a sort of a black eye smudge underneath it is now really starting to change significantly. And so we're going to be looking very carefully at this evolution for quite some time. We've only shown you a tiny fraction of the images that we have. And it's going to take quite a while before we put it all together. We have imaging coming down today. In fact, it just finished about 5 minutes ago. And so it would be very interesting to put all that together, a full map of Jupiter. We'll have a full map from before and a full map afterwards also. And I'll be very happy to show that to you at some time in the future. Finally, we're going to be imaging Jupiter a week from now and also a month from now. So we'll have some very good baseline on tracking the evolution of these cloud features. And I think I'll leave it with that and turn it back to the next speaker.
We can show the sequence now.
Oh, we can show the sequence. Oh, that would be great. If we could start with the first one. This is the very first image of this impact site that sent us all cheering and jumping up and down. You can see a little tiny streak. Now it's evolving. And we're morphing back and forth between the two so that you can see how very, very significantly it's changing and stretching
there.
And pulling towards that little feature off to the side. And the G impact site, which is even larger, is doing more even more interesting things than this. This is just a little padiddle, as Rita Beebe would say. The first impact, but it's still very interesting.
Okay, Melissa, are you ready for your report?
I'm ready, Gene.
Okay.
Heidi mentioned that G is a pretty impressive impact site, and earlier in the week we did some detailed studies of the light coming from that impact site. I think we have an image of that here, if we could bring it up. And a couple people reported on that earlier in the week, and we'll review that in a minute. But what I'd like to share with you today is some really exciting results that show that the chemistry and what we see from that site has changed dramatically. And if I could get the spectrum shown next, what we see now is, for the first time, clear evidence for material from the comet in this spectrum. The spikes over to the right-hand side of the spectrum are now emission from metals that's no doubt from the comet. It's not from Jupiter's atmosphere. And you can see that the height of those spikes tells us the intensity of the emission. Darker is toward the bottom in this diagram and brighter is toward the top. These emissions are from metals such as magnesium, silicon, and perhaps iron. So this is the first time we've really seen the comet, the leftovers from the comet in the impact site. To remind you, we also did observations earlier in the week on Monday, And if we could just go to those, this is the same location, the G impact site. This is what it looked like on Monday. And at that time, there was evidence for some unusual molecules in the atmosphere, molecular sulfur, ammonia, and carbon carbon disulfide, sorry, and hydrogen. Hydrogen sulfide. And that was very unusual. That was very surprising. And now if we could just go back and forth between these two. Now remember, this is the same region, and what we're seeing is very dramatic changes between the two sets of observations on Monday and on Thursday. This is the same place we're looking at, and you can see that it's changed dramatically. We could hardly believe our eyes when we saw this data, and it was very unexpected. We expected to see changes. We actually expected that perhaps the molecular sulfur would disappear because it supposedly has a very short lifetime. But much to our surprise, what we see instead is now evidence for material from the comet. If I could go to the last graphic I have, this is a diagram. You may recognize parts of it. It's sort of a takeoff from Andy Ingersoll's diagram yesterday, showing the comet going down into the atmosphere. We don't know what level in the atmosphere the fragments actually exploded, but we think that there's some evidence that it didn't reach the water cloud. We don't see any water. And inside the plume now, I've added some of the unusual things that we've observed from the G impact site, the molecules I just told you about. And now we've added some other little dots there, single atoms of the metals that we now see, which is evidence, direct evidence for the comet material. And I think I'll leave it at that, Gene. I could add that this was pretty much of a shock to us. So.
That's pretty exciting, yeah. Melissa. Well, David, what's happening in the amateur world?
Well, you know, I never cease to be amazed at the extent to which the amateur astronomers will go to get good images of this stuff. We have a report from an amateur astronomer who went to Jupiter, observing in Jupiter, to record, Jupiter, Florida. It's Jupiter, Florida. Well, all right, that's close enough.
He lives there.
He lives on Jupiter, yes. It's Michael Palmeretti. This is quite a neat image showing a Jupiter with dimples on it. It's a 20-inch telescope plus a CCD camera. Many amateur astronomers are using CCDs, and for small fields of view like the planets, they're really effective. And it's showing the two of the impact sites there quite clearly and in visible wavelengths, quite similar to what you'd actually see looking through a telescope. We also have, from Daniel Fischer, a very well-known German amateur astronomer, and he says, we are almost overwhelmed by the amount of detail visible with even a 16-inch, 0.4-meter Cassegrain telescope. He goes on, he says, not only are the L, G, and Q impact regions easily discernible, but it is possible to spot the some sub-phenomena within the spots. He says the G region consists of an extremely dark core, highly elongated, seems to have small extensions in various directions, surrounded for almost 150 degrees of its circumference by a lighter gray halo, which has a sharp edge, and he goes on in that vein.
You can even gate them straight.
Yeah, it's the hardest thing, and it's going to get even harder, as Carolyn's pointing out, to keep the sights straight, one from the other.
Well, I think that's an important role that amateurs
yes.
can play for us. The amateurs can help us keep track of what sites are located where, provided they make observations, collect images, or photographs and keep track of the times of their observations.
Yeah, exactly. And especially important to keep the observations coming at frequent intervals, which is going to get harder and harder as Jupiter gets closer into the twilight. Daniel Green and Steve O'Meara also observed more than anything else, the G impact site, by far the largest and most prominent last night. But they saw the G site easily visible through a 60-millimeter finder telescope. That is very, very small. And that kind of confirms what I was seeing the night before in the finder telescope. And this is an interesting thing, because I'm finding that the impact sites are often more easy to see. More easy? Okay, go back to do some literature. They are easier to see. It's been a long week. They're easier to see in smaller telescopes than they are in the big telescopes. Look at the picture that we just showed has the sites as being very fuzzy. But the contrast increases when you get to smaller telescopes. And with the very small ones, the 60 millimeters, maybe even 40 millimeters, they become very sharp, sharper than the shadow of a satellite. And they become easy to see. Green and O'Meara also noticed that site Q was quite noticeable. I think we were kind of hoping for more out of Q than we got, but it's still very exciting. These are just two representative reports of hundreds and hundreds of things that we're reading about and getting, and we'll continue to get over the next weeks. And well, back to you, Gene.
Well, I'm glad Dan Green is looking at these things, as he was one who was saying we weren't going to see anything, so I think maybe he's convinced now.
Well, he's eating his words, and I think he's finding that they taste very good.
Okay, well, I think it's time to get sort of the broader view and from all of our hard workers here. Heidi, what was the highlight of the week for you?
Well, the first highlight, I think, was just the fantastic imaging that the Hubble Space Telescope returned to us. I think that all of us were astounded by the quality. And what we saw in those images, plumes, ripples, incredible circulation in the atmosphere that is just starting to become apparent. All those things were just amazing. The auroral arcs as the fragments interacted with the magnetic field. Sulfur, I mean, just incredible. Seeing the comet pieces now, seeing their spectral signature, those were all just absolutely amazing highlights for all of us. I think, though, that the highlight we'll all take back with us is seeing the actual impacts occurring, seeing those very first images of the A impact that none of us expected to see. I think that was the biggest highlight for all of us, and the most exciting thing, and we actually have footage to show you of that. In case you want to see it again.
Something, why don't you go back?
This is the first time.
Yeah, this is the latitude that we're looking for something right there. Contours, you could tell pretty well that there wasn't too much depth. This is the 4 second, I think.
So there's a red spot, so you don't turn there.
Look!
Oh,
wow.
Yeah, that's it.
Oh, my God. Look at that. Look at that.
That's great. Lucy, I jumped over you there. What's happening now with observatories around the world?
Well, the observatories around the world are still sending us information.
With champagne or without it?
Well, you can't drink at most mountain observatories. So we have here an image from the Spirex image from the South Pole, which shows a fragment W and a composite of all the impacts, 11 of the 21 recorded at the South Pole. These show somewhere in here, and we can play games to see who can number the impacts correctly. There's A, C, E, G, H, K, L, N, Q, 1, R, and W. So how about those impacts? Now, Jupiter never disappeared from view at the South Pole. They did have some clouds and some bad weather. But they will continue to observe. Remember, it's nighttime at the South Pole, and the sun does not rise until September. So those of us who've been feeling sorry for ourselves at an observatory where the sun rises every day, think twice. Mm-hmm. Now, we also have a report from the Kuiper Airborne Observatory. We have spectral measurements from fragments R, V, and W. And they are seeing methane, ethane, and acetylene gases, which are already present in the atmosphere. Here we have a spectrum showing there these emission bands. These are seen in emission. They've been heated by the fragments from the explosion. And they're normally, they are not seen in emission in the Jupiter steady state atmosphere. Do we have a report from them? No, they also report.
The purpose is to get the teachers involved in hands-on real science. These folks actually do piggyback camera mounting on the main telescope on the airplane, and they do astrophotos. And so they really bring something very real back into the classrooms, and of course a lot of excitement as well.
And we think we just need to show scientists in action. We think that kids don't really have a chance to see scientists. We think they have a stereotype image of what scientists are like, and there have been very few opportunities for kids to see scientists working and experiencing and problem solving and making decisions and just being ecstatic when they get the results that they were hoping for.
This is the event of the year, but it just probably takes your breath away. So just to see them gives you goose pimples just to watch them get excited about each little impact. And I mean, I was glued to the monitor watching, you know, where we were flying and what they were doing and listening to the things on the headphone. I was trying to get as much of this down on film and on pencil and paper as I could.
The Kuiper Airborne Observatory has a program with teachers, and teachers and their students can fly experiments on board the aircraft. We have a video from the infrared telescope facility at Mauna Kea Observatory in Hawaii, and this video shows a sequence of the evolution of fragment C.
They're queuing up the tape now.
Okay.
They'll be up in just a moment.
There it is. Good.
Look at that.
Oh.
Okay, you can see the plume growing in intensity and then decaying. And as the planet continues to rotate, it will the impact scar rotates to the front of the planet as seen from Earth. We're going to show that again.
Where's that from again?
This is from the infrared telescope facility at Mauna Kea Observatory in Hawaii.
Is that the methane band there, 2.34?
My notes don't contain that information.
Must be,
I'm
though,
sorry.
Just from the appearance.
Doyle Hall from the University from Johns Hopkins University, excuse me, has a report for us from the Extreme Ultraviolet Explorer telescope. This is a near ultraviolet instrument.
NASA's Extreme Ultraviolet Explorer satellite has detected changes associated with cometary impacts on Jupiter. In the image, in the top panel, you see the image of Jupiter before the impacts. In the lower panel, you see the image of Jupiter during the impacts, and you can see a significant brightening. We think this is particularly significant because it tells us about Jupiter's upper atmosphere and how helium gas is mixed above and below absorbing layers. We think that during each cometary splash or plunge into the atmosphere, helium gas is splashed up, shot up into the upper layers of the atmosphere where we can see it. Normally, helium gas resides low enough that we cannot see it. It's masked by other gases that are above it.
Okay. In another set of experiments, the CINE experiment, Comet Impact Network experiment, which operates out of University of Arizona, headed by Steve Larson, has this network experiment has deployed coronagraphic instruments around the world, shown here marked in blue. It's unfortunate that we've had so many exciting results that we haven't had much time to highlight this network, but these observers were deployed to such exotic places as Diego Garcia in the Indian Ocean and all around the world. One of their most interesting reports is the report of a flash seen on Io during one of the earlier impact fragments, and I don't have the exact the impact. It was with G. Can someone confirm?
It's been retracted.
It's been retracted.
No. There were two reports. One report was cited earlier in the week by David Rabinowitz, and that still holds. Okay, there's one report of an increase in the reflectance of the satellite Io during an impact of one of the earlier fragments. Now, I received an interesting phone call a few days ago, and it was from a gentleman who identified himself as a contractor for the Defense Department. And he said he worked on something called AST, which stands for Airborne Surveillance Testbed. And this group was located in Hawaii, and it's a Boeing 767 aircraft with a 20-inch infrared telescope on board. And they were flying what they called a checkout mission. And in this checkout mission, because the airborne surveillance testbed usually looks down, they turned their telescopes to Jupiter. And they tell me that they have observed for 45 minutes before, during, and after the K impact. And they have their first data review in August. And I told them about the Division of Planetary Sciences meeting of the American Astronomical Society at the end of October. I sent them abstract forms, and they say they will be at the meeting to present their results. So we're eagerly looking forward to those. Now, finally, for teachers, I want to add that for teachers who are interested in receiving images, slides, and resources for their classroom, we will have available in mid-September a set of teaching materials, and you can contact your nearest regional teachers resource center if you know where that is. And if you're not sure where it is, you can call the phone number posted here below, area code 216-774-1051, extension 293. Can I give my summary now? I know it's a little long-winded. I have one more thing I want to say.
Go.
HST results were spectacular. I loved sitting here listening to it. I was always amazed at the new reports, magnetospheric effects on the North Pole of Jupiter. Another one of the surprises, we'll be enumerating it. But it's going to be the combination when we can all get together and talk to each other and calibrate our data first, and then talk to each other and say, what does this mean? And I have these results. And once we can combine our efforts and combine our data, we will know a lot more than we know already, and it's going to be a lot of fun.
Okay, thanks, Lucy. Well, Melissa, what's in store for Jupiter now?
Well, I'm going to let Heidi, she wanted to get in a brief word before I talk about what's in store for Jupiter.
Okay.
That's right. If we could actually put the graphic that's on the video, we got our order mixed up a little bit, so I got confused and forgot to say one thing. If you could put that lovely graphic of Jupiter. An image like this doesn't come from one person or one team. It comes from the work of many hundreds of very hardworking individuals at the Space Telescope Science Institute and at NASA. And I want to acknowledge all of those people. There are far too many to enumerate, but I just want to make sure that those people know that their efforts are very much appreciated, and that it's not just me or my team that did this work to produce a beautiful image like that for you. So that you should, all the people out there, you deserve the credit for that.
Okay,
thank
that's
you.
Great. Okay, what's the future now?
Now we do the prognostication for the future,
okay.
Right? Well, we haven't been overly successful at predicting what would happen this week, so I don't have a lot of confidence that I'm going to be able to really tell you what's going to go on in the future, but we'll give it a shot. We've already seen a lot of changes in the impact sites, the evolution of the morphology of the impact sites, and one of the things we don't know very much about on Jupiter is the winds high in the atmosphere. So one of the things we'll be continuing to study and learn something about from the evolution of the spots is the winds in the atmosphere. Now, I should also emphasize that the HST programs are not finished yet. There are many observations still to come. Heidi's program has several observations to follow what's going to be happening. I have a program that actually hasn't even started yet. It starts tomorrow. And many of the other programs will be doing follow-up observations. So we'll have plenty of time to see what's going to happen to Jupiter in the future. I think we expect continued evolution of those spots. Rita may still be waiting for a bubble to come up from deep in the atmosphere, so we may have that to look forward to. And we've already seen very dramatic changes in the chemical composition of the atmosphere. I think we expect to continue to see those kind of changes in the future. So we'll be watching to see what happens.
You're going to continue the spectroscopic
work. That's right. There are two more sets of spectroscopic observations coming up in August. So we'll have a chance to follow up on the dramatic changes we've already seen.
Okay, that's great. How about the amateurs, David? What are they going to be doing?
The most important thing that they're going to be doing is the nightly photographs of Jupiter as often as possible, as detailed as possible with as many different instruments. Make sure that you get the times and the dates accurate. Don't have the right time and be off by a day. if you're not sure, just say it's the date. Use a double date if you're not sure with the date changing at midnight. Make sure you have the time accurately. It's going to be a lot of fun. The best contribution the amateurs can make is the continual monitoring of the planet as far down into the twilight as you can.
All righty. Well, Don, maybe it's the time to turn the program back over to you for questions and answers.
Okay, well, before we start the Q&As, and I'm pretty sure we have a lot of them here, I would like to offer one brief video farewell to the comet. If we can roll that, please.
That's wonderful. Yeah.
And we'll be starting the question and answers now, but I'd like to say just before we get started that the Carolyn and Gene Shoemaker are going to have to depart in just a few minutes. So if anyone has questions for them, this would probably be the best time. Let's start with Q&A from here at Goddard. Anyone? Please state your name and affiliation.
I'm Kay Tamura from NHK, Japan Broadcasting. We've seen so many images that are taken from all over the place. Could you give me a rough estimate of about how many pictures were there throughout this observation?
Well, I know my program is going to have about 400, and that's just Hubble.
I got a report that one instrument had collected 904 images. That was from one instrument alone. And I counted this morning that there were 250 scientists on the exploder.
Thousands?
It's a lot.
Thousands of
images?
It's
a lot. Thousands of images, surely.
This will probably exceed the HaliWatch total for images taken. I know at our Near Nucleus Studies net, we had something like 3,000 or 4,000 images, and the large scale net had about the same. I think this is going to exceed that.
Right.
Because it's going to keep on going on.
Here in front.
Matt Crenson, the Dallas Morning News. I know this question has been asked before, but now that the week is over, have you seen any signs so far of anything that might cause permanent effects on Jupiter?
You want to try that, Heidi?
Well, the why not's easy. It's too soon to tell. Well, all we can say at this point is that the largest features are still hanging in there pretty well. The ejecta blankets or veils are starting to disperse, but we're still seeing very clearly even the A site. So I think we're just going to have to wait before we can give you a good answer to that question.
I think you should bear in mind that all the features that we see on Jupiter really are transitory. Even the great red spot has to have some finite lifetime. And so in terms of features you can see, they're not going to be permanent. But as David Levy said earlier in the week, you know, this is a process there that we're witnessing now that's been ongoing throughout the history of the solar system. And so, you know, just a little bit more has been added to Jupiter. It's permanently there. And so these are constituents now that have been added to the upper layers of Jupiter, and they're there.
I'll just add one comment, too, about the chemistry that we've talked about throughout the week. I think the analogy has been used several times of the Mount Pinatubo eruption on the Earth, how it threw a lot of junk high into the atmosphere of the Earth. And this is essentially what's also happened on Jupiter. And when it gets into a very stable part of the atmosphere like it is now, it will stick around for a long time. So we expect there not to be permanent necessarily forever, but we expect some of the chemical changes we've seen to be fairly long-lived.
Question in the back.
Mohammed Arif, Al-Hayat newspaper, Arabic daily newspaper. So I wanted only to say thank you for us coming from so far. It was a great time. And really, I would like to say thank you for the patience of Dr. Kalorein Shoemaker and Eugene Shoemaker and all the other scientists, for the patience they showed to sometimes our, well, most of the time, our silly questions maybe, which is, and it was a great pleasure and honor for us to come to this place. Thank you.
This is Mark Corot of the Houston Chronicle. I have a question for Dr. McGrath regarding the spectral emissions. Can you kind of explain, you characterize them as being surprising, and tell us why and what they mean in terms of the fragments. Do they tell you something that's not obvious?
I'm going to start answering the question. Maybe while I'm doing that, if we could bring up the two spectra again, and I'll speak a little bit to those if we can get them up. We tried to think what we would see, you know, when we wrote our proposals for observing time, and we thought hydrocarbons, that is carbon and hydrogen molecules, that they're normally present in the Jupiter atmosphere, but we thought we would see, you know, some unusual ones being formed. Instead of seeing hydrogen and carbon compounds and oxygen, as everybody's familiar with throughout the week, what we saw in the first spectrum was a lot of sulfur. And in the second spectrum, things have totally changed. Now, in these diagrams, toward the bottom is darker. If there were no change at all in the atmosphere, you would see a straight line on this plot. And that's what's shown at the top of the diagram. So those lines are significantly below no change. That means one of the things we've seen is the atmosphere's gotten much darker. We aren't getting nearly as much light out, especially at the impact sites. Now, that's not surprising because the images show that those regions are dark, and the spectra confirm that. So these more detailed studies of the light tell us partly why those regions are dark and what's there. There are particles there that we can't really study very well spectroscopically, but we can see the gas fairly easily. And we first saw a lot of sulfur, which we were fairly surprised about. And then the second time we looked, we expected that perhaps some of the sulfur would be gone, and it wasn't. And we were just totally surprised that now we see emission, or we see some of the leftover dust or junk from the comet actually glowing in the atmosphere. And that was very surprising to us. Another thing is that the second spectrum of the impact site, notice that most of that spectrum is toward the very bottom of the plot. So between the first and second times that we observed, things got much darker. And that was also somewhat of a surprise to us.
Don, I think we're going to have to make our getaway and catch our plane very soon. I wonder if we could ask Carolyn what her best memory of the week was.
I think my best memory is the same one that Heidi expressed so well at the beginning. Just the complete excitement of seeing fragment A and knowing that there were going to be better things to come. I think David and Jean and I, all three, feel a little like proud parents because this comet, this child, has lived up to all of the great expectations and the great desires that we had for it. And now it's not just our comet, it belongs to the whole world. And the team, the science team, is going to produce some absolutely great things in the days to come, and so are the amateurs, so are all of those that observe it. We're deeply grateful to all of you.
And we're grateful to you, too.
Very well. Thank you very much. It's been a pleasure for all of us and our very own Persons of the Week. And enjoy your trip back to Flagstaff. And thank you for being with us all this week.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right. Questions here? Paul?
Can you tell us precisely how many defined impact points you've been able to identify? And also, is there a possibility that the material in the so-called wings that are arriving at a later point, could any of them include fragments of the size that created some of the impacts that we saw from the alphabetic gang?
I'm sorry, who was the question for? Anybody? Well, I'll take a shot at it, and then maybe you'd like to add a few words, too. I think it's possible, yeah, that there are some chunks left in the terrain that we can't observe. And there's certainly plenty of dust, and that dust could continue to have some real significant effects on the atmosphere. Maybe you want to say a couple words, too.
If I might. Am I might?
Yeah. Yeah, you are. Mm-hmm.
We will be continuing to observe the atmosphere of Jupiter. So if there are additional small fragments, then we will probably pick them up, if not tomorrow, then next week. So we'll see.
Also,
I'm sorry?
The number of defined impact sites. That was the other question.
Ah.
How many?
Have we counted them? I think we saw almost all of the fragments. We haven't yet found V or T or U, but we haven't had an opportunity to look very carefully at the images yet. Some of those smaller ones were just teeny tiny little smudges, and so we'll have to look very carefully at where we expected them to be to know for sure whether or not they were there. So someone can do the math for me. Does that mean we detected 18 or 17?
I can only count up to 12 on my count.
So. Well, Lucy, one other point is, wasn't V the one that nobody reported detecting? Hasn't that been the one that there weren't any detections?
No, there were no reports of U and V. And there were some ground-based reports of T, but it was small.
So we'll probably find that one.
We haven't finished counting.
Yeah, and there's some separate ground-based programs, including one that I'm involved in up at Kitt Peak, that will be just starting in the next couple of days and looking for the small events that are taking place on our side of Jupiter as that trailing wing starts to hit.
Another question?
Jim Slayton, maybe you just answered that question, but I would like to know how much longer you expect the trailing material to be coming into Jupiter, how long you expect that to last, and is there any separate discernible effect of that material that you can tell at this point?
At least to the end of September. Initial estimates had it going all the way to Christmas, but now it's now probably going to fade out at the end of September. We don't expect to actually detect anything because these are really small fragments, like sand grain sized. But after what's happened this week, we're going to be watching very closely.
I looked at the exploder this morning, and there were no reports of any impacts past fragment W or any significant observations. But we wouldn't necessarily expect that because they're not that bright. And so people may have to work harder to pull the information out of their data.
I'll take one more question here before we go to the centers.
Dick Kerr, Science Magazine for Heidi. I'd like to understand that sequence of the W images again. That was the flash from the incoming bolide and then the outgoing plume.
I don't think that's what we were seeing there. I think what we were seeing is emission from the thing coming up, from the ejecta coming up, and it's hot. And we're seeing it even though it's in the shadow of Jupiter. It's self-luminous. and then it continues onward and upward spreading. And we actually have hints of that in some of the other images. We did see what this luminous emission in some of the other plumes. The very first one we saw, I think we saw it in E, and we weren't sure what to think. We didn't believe it. But then we saw it in G, then we saw it again here.
Roughly what kind of dimension is that upward feature?
Well, this was a pretty small plume, so maybe a thousand kilometers or so.
How about in width?
I don't have an estimate of that. A few thousand up. But
it's about the same width as it is tall, so.
Yeah, I mean, when are you talking about? The thing goes up and it spreads and then it's big and it's flat and so on. You should be very careful. That very first tiny little blip, that was probably, I'm guessing now that it was about 5 or 6 pixels tall, and it's 300 kilometers per pixel. Small. A few hundred kilometers. John's cueing me from the audience here. We obviously don't have our story together yet. We're working on that.
I think it will be interesting to compare the times of what the ground-based observers have been calling flashes with the times that Galileo brings back when they're looking straight down on the backside of Jupiter.
That's right. Part of the reason we don't have our story together yet, Dick, is that we only got this data at 8 o'clock last night. And so it's very hard to make a turnaround that quickly and get some firm numbers.
We're going to go to the Kennedy Space Center for questions now. And if you'll please state your name and affiliation.
This is Phil Chen, Earth News, from Melissa. Going back to your spectras, which conveniently don't have scales on the wavelengths, what instrument did you use for those? What do you make of the fact that so far no one's detected any water other than the one possible report?
Yeah, you noticed that we didn't put a wavelength scale or intensity on it, huh? That data was taken with the faint object spectrograph on the Hubble Space Telescope, and we don't have any evidence for water yet, and for the most part, no, even any oxygen-bearing molecules, so not just not water, but no oxygen at all. Why? If it's a comet, maybe it was a water-poor comet, but that's pretty unlikely because, as far as I know, I don't think there's ever been a comet observed with no water. If it's an asteroid, the oxygen may be bound up into silicates or grains, and maybe the oxygen has recombined into particles that are difficult to observe in the atmosphere, like sand, silicates. But really, we don't have a good answer, and I'd say that's one of the biggest puzzles from this week is where's the oxygen?
But Melissa, from ground-based observations at longer wavelengths, there have been reports of CO in emission, which is seen in Jupiter's atmosphere normally, and also reports of OH plus, and that's ionized hydroxyl. Now, that is in addition to the preliminary report or provisional report of the H2O. So there's still a lack of oxygen-bearing
species. That's right.
Species.
It's true that there have been those reports, but one thing to remember about the CO, for instance, is that, like Lucy said, it's normally present in the Jupiter atmosphere, and if you heat the atmosphere, it makes CO emit more. And so the fact that you see CO in emission doesn't mean there's more CO or enhanced CO. It may just mean that the temperature's higher, and I think actually we think that's the most likely explanation. No one's reported enhanced abundances of oxygen-bearing molecules, as far as I know. Right.
Okay, so even though David tried to convince us that because it looked like a comet, he's calling it a comet, but the definition of a comet is primordial body versus an asteroid is rubble, the jury's still out on that.
Well, I still hold to my definition of a comet as an observational one. I think it's, you have to remember that the solar system is a continuum of objects, and where does a grain of sand become a rock, and where does a rock become a boulder, and a boulder become a planet? And a planet become a gas giant, and a gas giant become a star. It goes from one to the other.
Then the solar system become the galaxy,
yeah.
And the galaxy be part of the universe.
And I'd much rather see the question worded in terms of where did this object get its start, and what is it made of, and what does it look like inside it? That's the important question, not what do we call it.
So we may have found something that's between an asteroid and a comet. So maybe it's a new kind of object. We don't know. Just to confuse things even more.
Okay, I'll accept that. Any idea on how bad the traffic jam was on the information superhighway, as Heidi put it? Just roughly how many downloads did you get from the various FTP sites?
I thought we heard a rumor of, wasn't there 126,000 downloads from Space Telescope? There was a pretty significant jam on the information superhighway this past week.
Let's see, I also heard one story from yesterday, I think it was, at Goddard, that 4,000 people at the same time, exactly the same time, tried to get in here, and it canned the computer. So it was pretty bad.
Okay, and one very big picture question. For the last over a week, you've been telling us wonderful things that we've been asking you for instant science, which you've given us. Now you get to think about it, look at it without having the entire world look at you through a fishbowl. What's going to happen? How are you going to convince us that what you told us preliminarily may not have been correct when you do find some more information and more data?
Well, that's the process of science, of course. You make hypotheses based on what you see, and then you think about it and try it out and see if you're right. And if you're right, that's great. But if you're not right, then you try it again. And we have so many people looking at these data, and we have so many different types of data on the same observation that I think we will be able to pull together a coherent story about what it was that happened on Jupiter this past week.
I agree, Heidi. I think that we have a lot of really fascinating pieces and a lot of big discoveries, and they'll come together, I think. They're a little bit jumbled right now, but there are still, you know, some really important knowledge that we have gained, pieces we have put in place. There are just a few more to be put together, and I have great confidence that we're going to be able to come up with a pretty coherent story.
We'll move to headquarters now. We have some questions there. Go ahead. Please state your name and affiliation.
Hi, this is Kathy Sawyer with the Washington Post. I have three questions, forgive me, for Dr. McGrath, I think. I'm still confused about why you were surprised at seeing molecules from the comet debris in the atmosphere, because I thought you had fully expected to see that. Second, I'm still confused as to whether we've had a confirmed flash on Io or not. And third, I'm still confused. I'm just very confused generally, but I'm confused about Rita Beebe's bubble. How does it differ from the fireballs that have been appearing? What is the difference between the gas bubble that she's been looking for, which has apparently not appeared?
Okay, well, why don't we do them in order? So I'll take the first one. No, we weren't surprised to see molecules at all. We expected to see molecules. The surprise is the molecules we see. We see sulfur molecules, and we didn't expect to see sulfur molecules, especially the ones we see. We expected to see carbon and hydrogen molecules and maybe some simpler molecules of sulfur. But the ones we're seeing are very unusual and were a fairly big surprise to almost everyone. So it wasn't the fact that we see molecules, it's which molecules we see. Lucy, Io. Flash on Io.
Io, yes. I'm confident to say that David Rabinowitz has reported a reddening of the spectrum of Io from his observations. And that was, so we have seen one report of a change in the spectrum of Io. And that's an unexpected result. People looked at many occultation reappearances, and they looked at the satellites a lot, and we were expecting to see the flashes, and it just didn't happen. But there was this one report.
And now to talk about Rita's bubble. The thing that we were seeing, if you could show Melissa's graphic, but it's just as good as ours was when Andy talked about the booms.
On, it's a lot better.
It's better.
It's got the clouds a lot better.
It's got chemistry in it. What we were seeing with these plumes is the ballistic explosion created, you know, the ballistic outflow, a gigantic gas of bubble created transiently, very briefly during the explosion. So that's a very short-lived phenomena. What Rita is hoping to see is that
down at that very point of that thing where the thing actually did explode, and we don't know exactly where that is, but at that point of the explosion, that there's where another bubble of disturbed atmosphere has been created, which will eventually work its way out to the surface and create a new surface feature. Not a transient, well, it'll be transient, but not very brief like we've already seen. So that's the difference between the plumes and the spots that we've seen and the bubble that we hope will well up over the next few days.
Any further questions from headquarters? Okay, let's come back here to Goddard. Here in front row.
A.R. Hogan, Writers Plus Newsroom. For Dr. Hamill, will you be mounting a campaign to actively look for the possibility of impacts not only in the future on Jupiter, but on other planets in the solar system, even though it may be kind of a long shot? And my other question is, do you have any specific plans for the Galileo spacecraft that were not already in the works based on this event? And do you have any hopes or prospects for post-Galileo Jupiter missions that might be altered because of this event, please?
The first question, do we have plans to look for other impacts on other Galilean, other Jovian planets? Certainly, we look at the planet's atmospheres and study them. I don't think we will be mounting a campaign to look for this kind of phenomenon simply because it's so rare. If we see another comet, if another comet is discovered by the Shoemakers and David Levy or other people, and it's on some collision course for doom with Saturn, then I'm sure we will try to mount a campaign to study that particular event. There were so many questions. What was the second question?
The other part of the
Galileo, would this change?
Any specific deltas in your Galileo observation plans, and any prospects or hopes for post-Galileo missions?
I'm not a member of the Galileo team, so I can't speak to what their plans will be. Certainly, they will be looking very closely at what we know were impact sites to see if there are any remnant effects at that point in time when Galileo is in orbit around Jupiter. And as to whether or not we will have any further missions, I know that NASA has many plans for missions to other things. I'm not sure if we're going to need to mount a mission to Jupiter just to see the effects of this comet crash. I don't think that's too likely.
I'd like to bring up a point. The timing of this impact was very fortuitous because Galileo is on its way to Jupiter and will get there in 1995. And on that spacecraft, the spacecraft will release a probe that is going to penetrate into Jupiter's atmosphere. So some of the questions that we will raise when we analyze our data, we will have an opportunity to try and answer them or confirm some of our results from these impacts with the Galileo spacecraft mission.
More questions?
Ron Cowan with Science News. I guess these questions are for Melissa. How do you know that the metals that you saw in that spectra are from the comet, not from Jupiter? Why do you think you didn't see them earlier? Do you think they weren't there earlier? And lastly, the fact that you saw these elements, does that indicate anything about how far how deep these impacts went or how high they went in the stratosphere?
I'll take the let's see if I can remember all the questions. Why didn't we see the emissions before is one I'll try first. If you remember, the first spectrum I showed you was reasonably high compared to the zero change. The second one where we see the metals and the emissions, what we call the continuum, sort of the background light from the planet, was much, much lower. And so one possibility is that because the continuum, the background level of light dropped, we were able to see the emissions more easily on top of that. Why that happened, we're not exactly sure, but it could be that the cloud is sort of clearing out of material and stuff is raining down, dropping the background, and on top of that, we see this leftover junk from the comet that's glowing. Let's see, you have to remind me of the rest of the questions.
No, it's not from Jupiter.
If Jupiter, well, the comet and Jupiter are thought to have sort of the same kinds of abundances of most materials, but you don't see the heavier stuff in the atmosphere, in the clouds and so forth. It's deep down in the center of the planet, if there. So we know almost without a doubt that when we see the metals, and it's actually the other spectrum that shows that it's leftover material from the impactor, be it comet or asteroid or whatever you want to call it. And I think that there's not much doubt about that.
Right, and I was asking, just wondering if seeing the metals could tell you how deep these fragments went into Jupiter.
I think it probably doesn't. I think it's more likely that it's going to tell us something about the abundances of these metals in the original body.
I have a question in the back.
Yes, this is a question for Lucy McFadden. I'm wondering about radio observations. Have you had a chance at all to look through the exploder for reports from radio observatories? And if so, what have or haven't they reported?
Yes, thank you. That's Steve Benka from Physics Today, and thank you for asking that question, Steve. I received a report from Ari Grossman from University of Maryland and Dewey Mulliman at Caltech, who have made observations at the VLA, the Very Large Array, in New Mexico. And they have observed the planet through whole rotations and have done a preliminary analysis of their results. With the VLA, they can look down deep to the ammonia clouds, which are below the stratosphere. And they report on the exploder that they see no evidence of any perturbations or changes as Jupiter rotates. And I'm sure as they complete the analysis of their results, you will be hearing from them, because that's very significant. I have one more report from the Ulysses spacecraft, which is primarily a radio experiment. And Ulysses is on its way into a polar orbit around the sun. It's looking back at Jupiter. It had a gravity assist from Jupiter as it was shot into its orbit heading for the sun. And they report seeing no significant detections on their instruments. And this negative result tells us something about the whole picture, and we will be hearing from them. I'm sure it's disappointing for them not to have any signal to analyze, but nevertheless, that's important for the big picture. And then also Voyager. The ultraviolet spectrometer on Voyager at 40 AU reports no significant detection. But given the results from HST, that we're producing dark spots, and since they're observing it at shorter wavelengths, I'm just not surprised that there's no flux for them to detect.
I'm just going to chime in, too, that there's also been extensive observations of the decametric and decimetric radiation from the Jovian magnetosphere throughout the impact week. And one, the decimetric measures synchrotron radiation from the radiation belts around Jupiter. And neither of those teams from around the world have reported anything unusual. You know, they've reported seeing changes, but nothing that's more significant than the normal emission you see from Jupiter. So it doesn't seem that there was extensive damage to the emissions from the Jovian magnetosphere.
Miles.
Miles O'Brien with CNN. What are the latest and best estimates on the size of these fragments, and how precise will we be on that when all is said and done?
Somebody from our team, flash up. Okay, I was going to say two, Andy, so Hal says four, Andy says three. I would say a few. Less than five and greater than one, is that okay?
Kilometers.
And actually, like I said before, a lot of pieces of the puzzle are in place. I think that actually we're going to be able to get a fairly accurate estimate, better than saying less than five and greater than one, to the sizes.
Probably the combination of the plumes that we can image from the shapes of them, combined with the infrared observations at many wavelengths to really accurately know the temperatures, I think that will help us quite a bit to determine the body's sizes.
Follow up.
Scientists, before the impact, a lot of scientists were talking about analyzing the seismic waves, which were caused by some of these impacts. I might have missed something, but I haven't heard much of talk about that and what those seismic waves may have told scientists.
One
telescope where they were, their main objective was to look for the seismic waves, had bad weather for most of the week. So they sat frustrated for days. They have reported getting some information, but the nature of their instrumentation and their experiment is not such that they're going to, you know, be able to see the image right away or see the effects of what they're looking for right away. And plus, since it was the end of the week, they've got to disentangle everything from all the impacts, from all the direct impacts, and try and figure out what the what is reflected signal that was bounced off from the more dense layers in the interior. So we don't have any positive results yet, but I'm going to be patient and see what they can pull out of their data in subsequent analysis.
I was just going to say it's very difficult measurements to make at best. The predictions were saying that the effect would be small. And even if they don't see something, I think in the end that'll be another piece of the puzzle, i.e. it'll help constrain the size of the fragments. And did you want
I was going to say something along the same lines. It's going to be a very painstaking process to pull that information out of the data. I mean, there was nothing obvious, but that doesn't mean that there's nothing there. We've only been able to hit the highlights during this week because we've all been so busy taking data. We haven't had time to do very careful studies of what's in there.
More questions here at Goddard? Okay, well, before we close the briefing, I just want to take just a moment to, if you will indulge me, to tell you the story behind how we have brought you some of these extraordinary images and stories here. The NASA and National Science Foundation Worldwide Observing Effort came together, as you know, over the past several months, but there had not been plans for a mission control of sorts where a central facility where all the information could be pulled together other than the internet and the scientists talking to each other. But in order to bring together these images and reports from Hubble, Keck, IRTF, and many other observatories around the world, we put together a team here at Goddard and the Space Telescope Institute, who've put out a tremendous effort around the clock to make this happen so we can bring all of these images and reports to you and make available the scientists that you see here and the Shoemakers and Dave Levy. And I want to thank all of them for their time and effort in telling this tremendous story and bringing the excitement of the scientific discovery that we've seen this week. And thank you very much for making that so successful. A few other people that I want to mention are Dave LaCrone and Malcolm Niedner here of Goddard, as well as Ed Barker and Ed Weiler of headquarters, who provided invaluable scientific guidance, Jan Ruff and Mike Finneran, and the Goddard Public Affairs staff, who worked around the clock, and the Space Telescope Institute Public Affairs staff, and Pat Kennedy and the NASA TV crew, who got us on the air and made everything look good, and the NASCOM staff, the Goddard Institute Photo Lab, and the Institute Photo Labs, and Walt Zimmer of the Space Telescope Institute, through whose wizardry, we're able to get these extraordinary pictures, and Eric DeYoung at JPL for his visualizations and animation, and finally, Trish Pingra and Ginger French, the producers who've worked a minor miracle in bringing all of this together. Excuse me. I want to thank all of you very much for making all of this happen, and I apologize to all of those many people who I didn't mention by name. Excuse me. And thank you all for joining us here today and for the previous week. And that will conclude our briefings. Thank you, panelists.
Thank you. Thank you, Don.
happen.
So it's on the way on the other side. Okay, we're looking for something much combat.
This is the first over.
Yeah, this is the latitude that we're looking for something right there. Contours, you could tell pretty well that there wasn't too much there.
That's the shortest one.
This is the 4 second.
So there's a red spot, so you know. Atlas and Condor.
Look! Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's it.
Oh, my God.
That's it.
Look at that. Look at that.
The purpose is to get the teachers involved and hands-on real science. These folks actually do piggyback camera mounting on the main telescope on the airplane, and they do astrophotos. And so they really bring something very real back into the classrooms, and of course a lot of excitement as well.
We think we just need to show scientists in action. We think that kids don't really have a chance to see scientists. We think they have a stereotype image of what scientists are like, and there have been very few opportunities for kids to see scientists working and experiencing and problem solving and making decisions and just being ecstatic when they get the results that they were hoping for.
This is the event of the year, but it just probably takes your breath away. So just to see them gives you goose pimples just to watch them get excited about each little impact. And I mean, I was glued to the monitor watching, you know, where we were flying and what they were doing and listening to the things on the headphone. I was trying to get as much of this down on film and on pencil and paper as I could.
Ultraviolet Explorer satellite has detected changes associated with cometary impacts on Jupiter. In the image, in the top panel, you see the image of Jupiter before the impacts. In the lower panel, you see the image of Jupiter during the impacts, and you can see a significant brightening. We think this is particularly significant because it tells us about Jupiter's upper atmosphere and how helium gas is mixed above and below absorbing layers. We think that during each cometary splash or plunge into the atmosphere, helium gas is splashed up, shot up into the upper layers of the atmosphere where we can see it. Normally, helium gas resides low enough that we cannot see it. It's masked by other gases that are above it.